Okay, so I'll be actually giving two talks back to back about two projects that I've had while I was working here. Okay, so the first project I'd like to talk about is the IoT doorbell that I've built for this office. Okay, so I'll first begin with the problem. Okay, so we actually moved into this office quite recently in December last year, and this office did not come with a doorbell. So so I thought instead of having just a normal like push button and ring, right, why not I built an over-engineered IoT doorbell? Okay, so this is the solution that I thought of. So of course it must first function as a normal doorbell, it must ring whenever the button is pressed. That's number one. So number two is we actually use Slack. And so Slack is like instant messaging app here. So whenever the button is pressed, the doorbell will inform our Slack channel that somebody's outside. Okay, then there's also a camera there. So it take a photo of the visitor and upload it to Slack also. Then the fourth thing, this is more of optimization. I want my doorbell to be reliable. So I need to, for example, things somebody can accidentally turn off the doorbell, like contractors and so on. So I don't want it to have any issues. Okay, so this is where the file system resilience comes in. Okay, so I have my demo now. I think one of my colleagues is stationed there. Is it? Is it there? Okay, so now I'll show you the Slack channel here. Okay, so you can see some of you did press the doorbell just now, right? Yeah, so it's all captured there. Okay, so my colleague Vina, she just pressed the doorbell. So you can see that, yeah, it's taken and uploaded to our Slack channel. So whoever's in this Slack channel will be informed that this particular visitor is here. So thanks Vina for that. Okay, yeah, so let me close this. Okay, so I first started out with a minimum viable product. So this is made up of a Raspberry Pi 3. And I use a camera, so 8 megapixel camera, this Sony camera, and it's connected via the CSI interface. So you can see this one over here. Okay. Then as for the sound, right, the sound is generated by this buzzer, 3 volt, 20 volt, continuous buzzer. And to simulate a button press, I just use a wire, then I shot this wire to ground. Yeah, so this is, it's equivalent to a button press. Okay. Then as for the button itself, so I wanted the button to be something that is familiar to most people, so I just took a normal doorbell like this. Then you can see that I've put the SD card here, adapter here, so we can get a reference of its size. Then open it up. Then I find out where the button pins are. Then I just wire some jumper wires here to where the button is. And the other end of this wire is connected to my Raspberry Pi. And also another thing is that these kind of buttons are usually more reliable than the ones if I try to make one myself. Okay, so for the camera. So the camera, I chose one that has a fisheye lens. So this has a lower resolution of 5 megapixel, but it's not important as I'll explain later. So this one is 160 degrees wide. So the usual default Raspberry Pi camera is only 72 degrees. So I wanted something that's wider. Then the flex cable, I chose the one that is longer because later you all can see the camera is outside, but I want my Raspberry Pi to be inside for obvious reasons. I don't want anyone to tamper with it. So the default length of this flex cable when you buy this camera is only 10 centimeters. It's too short. So yeah, I got the longer one, 70 cm. So I just got it from C-Studio, the whole set. Okay, then next. Okay, then this is the camera settings I use. So in the Raspberry Pi, they actually provide this program called Raspi Steel. Okay, so you just run this program with the settings that you want. So these are settings that I actually settled on. So I actually, because I want the image to be uploaded fast, and I don't need such a very high resolution. So the resolution that I set is only a low 640 by 480. I don't even use the full 5 megapixel capability. Don't need to care about that. Yeah, then the JPEG quality, I just set at 30%. And in terms of rotation, right, I had to actually rotate because you see on the bottom right picture, the camera is actually mounted at the angle. It's not mounted straight on, so that the flex cable can actually wrap around the wall to the other side. So this camera is mounted sideways, so I need to rotate by 270 degrees. Then also, there's actually for this particular program, there's a 5 seconds delay by default. When you press or when you call this program Raspi Steel, it waits 5 seconds. Then it takes the image. So yeah, I don't know why they set this kind of default. So I just set a 1 millisecond picture taking delay. I started actually with 0, but 0 for some reason doesn't work. So I just set 1 millisecond. So with the result of all of these settings, I get about 100 kilobyte file size, small enough and fast enough to be uploaded. Yeah, another one is the ISO settings, 840 mm shutter speed. I want it to be taken quite quickly lah. I don't want too much delay. Okay. Any questions? No, right? Okay. So now the part about the Slack integration. So whoever is in the office Slack channel will be able to see that somebody's outside. So how do I do it? So the first thing about Slack is you have to create a bot. So a bot is something like a special user, but it's not a normal human user. So let me show you. Yeah, just go to this site here. Then see, run code, listen, and post your Slack thing just like as a user would. Then I will need to use several APIs. So let me go back to the doorbell again. So you see, the first message that I send is called visitor is here. Then I upload the image. Okay, so the reason why I do this is because the image takes about a few seconds to upload, even though it's just 100 kilobytes. So I push a first short message out first. This short one. So this message will be out within 1 second. Then this image will follow on later. Okay, so to post this particular message, so I just use this API here, Slack API. You can check this out when you go home. Yeah, so just make a post request to it. As for the file uploading, I use this particular API, the files upload API. So they provide everything. Okay, so let me continue. Okay, so actually I started out initially with the Python SDK for Slack. So actually Slack, they provided this SDK so that you don't have to necessarily go and make your own post request to call to the Slack servers. But there's actually a bug with their Python SDK in terms of image uploading. So actually someone actually posted here. So what it means here is that a bot has issues uploading pictures. A user doesn't have this problem. So because of that, I don't have a choice. I have to upload it manually without this Python SDK. Okay, so yeah. Okay, for the operating system, I use Arch Linux as my favorite for this kind of projects. It's lightweight and then it's out of the box. It's very minimal packages. Yeah, no nothing. So it's very light and very small image size. Then the cutting edge, everything's the latest. Like all this, for example, Node.js is latest, Python 3 is the default. I know many Linux distributions still use Python 2 as a default. Okay, then I've disabled SSH for security reasons. So only console cables allowed for this. Yeah. Okay, let me continue. And the final point about this one is that I use a read-only file system because as I mentioned earlier, somebody can accidentally turn off the power and this can cause file system corruption. And so next time when you power on, right, the system might not be able to start up. So I have to go to the etc fstat file, then set all these few settings. Like for example, here I mount the boot file system as read-only. Then for certain directories that need write, for example, temp and log write, I transfer it to tempfs, which is actually a RAM drive. Then for the root directory, it has to be modified in this file, command-line.txt, just set the RO option. And the root will be read-only. There's also journaling. So journaling, I set storage none. So I minimize the amount of stuff that goes to var log. Okay, so any questions for this part before I move on to the next talk? Okay, yes?
Having a read-only file system mean that you cannot remotely apply security controls?
Okay, so a read-only file system can be, I can override it when necessary. So I have actually a shell script that says if I need to update, I just set write enable, update, then reboot. Okay, any more questions? Okay, so now I move on to my second talk.